وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ.
بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. الدرس العاشر, the 10th lesson. This is the second recording for the 10th lesson. Make sure you've heard the first recording before this one, because the first recording, it contains explanation of the main principles of the 10th lesson. As I had said back then in that recording, the 10th lesson contains a few new principles. They are quite simple, but they're extremely frequently used in Arabic, so you need to make sure you understand them. And understanding is not the difficult part, but just make sure you spend time to practice using these principles in sentences, especially from real life sentences. So once you've understood the last recording, then you could go through this recording with the passage and the exercises. But as you go through the exercises, see if you can make sentences, other sentences such as this one, and ask these questions to yourself and others. And then once you finish with lesson 10, lesson 11 that follows this one, that sort of like recaps and puts all the things together from this lesson and the previous lesson in a passage form. So let's do this lesson now first, having done the principles of this lesson in the previous recording. And remember again to practice these by yourself, not just to suffice with what's here in these exercises, but make other sentences like that by yourself and do these exercises a couple of times. As I had mentioned earlier, you would do well to write the answers in a separate exercise book such that the textbook remains empty, so you can come and look at the textbook at another time later and try to do the answers without looking at the previous answers that you have done in the other exercise book. So this way it would give you more practice and it would serve as some sort of a test, and also that helps you to learn quicker and better as well. Before starting at Dars al-Ashir, I'll have a look at the al-kalimat al-jadida and their meanings, because this would help us thereafter to go a bit more smoothly. If you flick right to the back of Ad-Dars al-Ashir, the 10th lesson, it says Al-Kalimatu al-Jadidatu, the new words. And the new words are as follows. Az-Zamilu. Az-Zamilu is the colleague. Az-Zamilu is the colleague. So Zamil is someone, Zamilun is someone who works with you or studies with you, is a workmate or a study mate or whatever it may be, someone who is with you. They may not necessarily be your friend, but they at least they work with you or study with you and so on. So Az-Zamil is a colleague. Next, Az-Zawju. Az-Zawju is the husband. Az-Zawju is the husband. What is the wife in Arabic? Az-zawjatu. Az-zawjatu is the wife. The next word, wahidun. Wahidun means one. Wahidun means one. Fatan. Notice fatan ends with the alif maqsura. It's a ya without the two dots, and it's pronounced as an alif but written as a ya. And as we had said earlier, in examples such as mustashfa, this at the end, it's called alif maqsura, it's pronounced as a long alif. So you say, and it does not take dhamma or kasra, so you say fatan, always with a fatha, fatan. The next word after that is ma'a, and ma'a works like a mudaf and mudaf ilayh, or like a harf al-jar, making the word after it have kasra, and it means with. So ma'a means with. At-tiflu. At-tiflu is a little baby. At-tiflu is a little baby. In Arabic, at-tiflu is a little baby, like a newborn baby, and immediately after that, then as it grows up, it's called a al-ghulamu. Al-ghulamu, as it grows up into a boy. And then as it grows older, it's called a fata or fatan. Fatan for masculine, and its plural of fatan is fityatun. As you see in Surah Al-Kahf in the Quran, fit innahum fityatun amanu bi rabbihim. Fityatun is the plural of fatan, and that is a youth, a male youth. That would be someone who is like in their teenagers. And then as they grow older, you would call them a shabun. A shabun. And shab is from, let's say, from late teenage or adolescent years, from adolescent years until around about 33, according to some scholars, and according to some scholars, until 40 years of age. And then after that, you say kahlun, and that's used in the Quran as well. And when that's in the Middle Ages, and then when a person gets old, they are called sheikhun. These are for the masculines. For female, you would say tiflatun, for a baby girl, and ghulamun, also for an older one, and fatatun for a girl who is teenage years roughly, and its plural is fatayatun, and shabatun for a girl who is adolescent to older, and then for an old woman you say ajuzun. The next word in the list is al-Kuwaitu. Al-Kuwaitu is of course a country, Kuwait. Al-Kuwaitu, and the next word al-Lughatu. Al-Lughatu means the language. These are the new words listed at the end of Dars al-Ashir. Now let's have a look at the passage in the beginning of the 10th lesson, having looked at the vocabulary already and the rules that are introduced already. It should not take us long to go through this one now, and you can revise these ones if you need to. Hamid says, Man anta? Man anta? Who are you? Muhammad replies, Ana talibun bil jami'ati. Ana talibun bil jami'ati. B is a harful jar. B is a harful jar, just like fi, min, ila, ala. And B comes with a comprehensive meaning, and it gives meaning such as in or by or with. So here, Ana talibun bil jami'ati, meaning I am a student at the university or in the university. Ana talibun bil jami'ati. So B is a harf al jar, makes a word after it have a kasra, and it comes with the meanings of in, with, or by, or at, and so on. Ana talibun bil jami'ati. Hamid asks, A anta talibun jadidun? A anta talibun jadidun? Are you a new student? Talibun jadidun is na'at and man'ut. Muhammad replies, Na'am. Ana talibun jadidun. Yes, I am a new student. This, of course, we did in the 9th lesson. Hamid asks, Min aina anta? Min aina anta? From where are you? Min, from, aina, where, anta, you. Min aina anta? Muhammad replies, Ana min al hindi. I am from India. Ana min al hindi. Notice, min is mabni and finishes with a sukun all the time at the end. But here, the noon of min ends with a sukun, and the first letter of al-hind has a sukun. You cannot pronounce two sukuns together, so therefore, the min, you just put a fatha for pronunciation only. It has nothing to do with grammar, only to do with pronunciation, because otherwise you would not have been able to pronounce two sukuns together. So you say, instead of min, and the other word, l-hind, you cannot pronounce the lam with sukun, so you say min al-hindi. Ana min al-hindi. I am from India. Hamid asks, Ma, what, ismuka, your name, masmuka, what is your name? Muhammad replies, Ismi, my name. Notice, it's mudaf mudaf ilayh. E is the damir for I, or mine. Ismi Muhammadun. My name is Muhammad. Hamid asks again, وَمَنْ هَذَا الْفَتَى? And who is this youth? And who is this young boy? وَمَنْ هَذَا الْفَتَى? For further information, he specifies and says, الَّذِي مَعَكَ, the one who is with you. مَعَ, with, كَ is damir for you. مَعَكَ, with you. وَمَنْ هَذَا الْفَتَى الَّذِي مَعَكَ? And who is this young boy, the one who is with you? Muhammad replies, Huwa zamili. Huwa zamili. He is zamili. Zamili is mudaf mudaf ilay. Zamil, colleague. E, mine. Zamili, my colleague or colleague of mine. Huwa zamili. Notice al-fata ends with an alif maqsura, and therefore it does not have dhamma or kasra. Always you say a at the end of such words. So that's why we said وَمَنْ هَذَا الْفَتَى. Muhammad replied, هُوَ زَمِيلِي. He is my colleague. So Hamid asks, أهو أيضا من الهندي؟ Is he also from India? A is for question. هو he أيضا also من الهندي from India. Notice you can put أيضا at the end as well, and you can just as well say أهو من الهندي أيضا. Is he also? Is he from India also? So the أيضا can come where it is, or it can come right at the end as well. أهو أيضا من الهندي. Is he also from India? Muhammad replies, لا, no. هو من الياباني. He is from Japan. هو من الياباني. He is from Japan. Hamid asks, ما اسمه? What is اسمه? اسمه is مضاف مضاف إليه. Name of his name. ما اسمه? What is his name? And for details, you can go back to the recording with explanation of the principles, where I did spend some time on this. Hamid asks, ma ismuhu, what is his name? Muhammad replies, ismuhu hamzatu, ismuhu hamzatu, ismuhu his name, ismuhu his name, hamzatu is the khabar, ismuhu hamzatu, his name is Hamza, ismuhu Hamzatu. His name is Hamza. Notice Hamzatu, name of a male person, but it appears and seems like a female because it has a ta marbuta at the end. Therefore, just like a female name, we do not pronounce a tanween on it. The reply, Ismuhu Hamzatu. Notice the type, you say, his name is Hamza. His name is Ismuhu Hamzatu. This is quite common in Arabic to form sentences of this type. And we will see more examples of this, such as لغته اليابانية, his language is Japanese. Or لغتك اليابانية, your language is Japanese, and so on. Hamid further asks, ما لغتك يا محمد? ما لغتك يا محمد? What is your language, O Muhammad? What is your language, O Muhammad? ما لغتك يا محمد. لغتك again مضاف مضاف إليه. لغة مضاف ك مضاف إليه. ما لغتك يا محمد. What is your language, O Muhammad? Notice محمد drops the تنوين when you put the حرف النداء O, which in Arabic is يا. When you put يا محمد, the تنوين on محمد drops and you just say one ضمه يا محمد. ما لغتك يا محمد. محمد replies, لغتي الأردية. لغتي الأردية. لغتي is مضاف مضاف إليه. لغتو is مضاف, meaning language. E is the ضمير pronoun for mine. My language, لغتي الأردية, is Urdu. My language is Urdu. Hamid asks, أهي لغة سهلة؟ أهي لغة سهلة؟ لغة سهلة from الدرس التاسع, from the ninth lesson, is نعت and منعوت. لغة سهلة, an easy language. هي لغة سهلة, it is an easy language. Put a آ before it, you may turn it into a question. Is it an easy language? أهي لغة سهلة. Muhammad replies, نعم, yes, هي لغة سهلة. Yes, it is an easy language. Yes, it is an easy language. Hamid asks again, وَحَمْزَةُ, and Hamza, مَا لُغَتُهُ, what is his language? Notice here how he asks. He could have said, مَا لُغَتُ حَمْزَةُ. He could have said that. Instead, just another way of saying, which is perfectly fine, he said, وَحَمْزَةُ, مَا لُغَتُهُ, and Hamza, what is his language? ما what لغته مضاف مضاف إليه, his language. Muhammad replies, لغته اليابانية. لغته اليابانية. His language is اليابانية, Japanese. His language is Japanese. وهي لغة صعبة, and it is لغة صعبة, a difficult language. نعت and منعوت, لغة صعبة, a difficult language. لغته اليابانية. You said ال because Japanese, you want to make it definite to make it into the language, and you will see later on why we do that. لغته اليابانية وهي لغة صعبة. It is a difficult language. صعبة, there is two dhamma at the end, تنوين. No shadda, as is a typing error in some prints of this book. وهي لغة صعبة. Hamid asks, أين أبوك يا محمد؟ أين أبوك يا محمد؟ And where is أبوك, your father, O Muhammad? And where is your father, O Muhammad? أبوك, as I said in the explanation of the rules, أب and أخ are two of the five or six words in the Arabic language. When they are mudaf, you, instead of just a dhamma, you add a waw at the end of the word when it is mudaf. So instead of أبوك, you say أبوك. أين أبوك يا محمد? Where is your father, O Muhammad? Muhammad replies, أبي في الكويت. هو طبيب شهير. Says أبي في الكويت. في الكويت is جار مجرور. حلف الجر في, and the اسم مجرور, meaning the noun that is مجرور. مجرور is any noun that ends with a كسرة. الكويت is مجرور because it has في before it. Therefore, في الكويت. أبي في الكويت. My father is in Kuwait. أبي is my father. The origin of it, you would have said أبا واو and then يا. But then واو and يا, you cannot put them together in pronunciation. So you leave the واو and you say أبي في الكويت. Or واو sort of merges into the يا because you cannot really pronounce it. So you say أبي في الكويت. My father is in Kuwait. هو طبيب شهير. He is طبيب شهير, a famous doctor. طبيب شهير is نعت and منعوت. A famous doctor. شهير نعت طبيب منعوت. هو طبيب شهير. أبي في الكويت هو طبيب شهير. وأين أمك? And where is your mother? وأين أمك? And where is your mother? أمك again is مضاف مضاف إليه. Your mother. وأين أمك? Muhammad replies, هي أيضا في الكويت مع أبي. هي مدرسة هناك. Can you understand the meaning of the sentence? هي أيضا في الكويت. She is also in Kuwait. مع أبي. With أبي is مضاف مضاف إليه, meaning my father. She is also in Kuwait with my father. هي أيضا في الكويت مع أبي. Notice the word after مع should have كسرة, and أبي, the ba already has a كسرة because it's مضاف. It's got a يا after it to ease its pronunciation. It has a كسرة at the end anyway. So مع makes أب become مجرور and have grammatically a كسرة. هي أيضا في الكويت مع أبي. She is also in Kuwait with my father. هي مدرسة. She is a teacher. مدرس is مذكر, male teacher. مدرسة is female teacher. هي مدرسة هناك. She is a female teacher over there. هناك, over there. Hamid asks, أذهبت إلى الكويت يا محمد? Did you go to Kuwait, O Muhammad? أذهبت. ذهبت. Notice تا at the end, as we said in the explanation recording before this. تا is a ضمير pronoun for you. ذهب is فعل ماضي. ذهبت. You went. Past tense for you went. أذهبت. Did you go إلى الكويت to Kuwait? يا محمد, أو محمد. أذهبت إلى الكويت يا محمد? And Muhammad replies, نعم ذهبت. Yes, ذهبت. I went. تو is for I. So ذهب is فعل ماضي, and you add the pronoun تو for I went. تا is for you went, as in the previous sentence. In this sentence, we added تو, ذهبت, meaning I went. نعم ذهبت. حامد says, وزميلك أين أبوه? زميلك. What's زميلك? That's another مضاف and مضاف إليه. زميل means colleague. and it's mudaf, therefore it has dhamma on it. Ka is mudaf ilayh, meaning you, zamiluka. And this mudaf ilayh, as we said, is mabni. As I said in the explanation, it is mabni, therefore the ending of this does not change due to the grammatical position. Zamiluka, your colleague. Wazamiluka, and your colleague. Aina abuhu, where is abuhu, his father? Notice how you're using two pronouns in this sentence. Wazamiluka, aina abuhu, and your colleague, where is his father? Ab, as I said, when that comes as a mudaf, you put a waw along with the dhamma at the end of it. Aina abuhu, where is his father? Wazamiluka, aina abuhu. Muhammad says, abuhu fil yabani. Muhammad says, abuhu fil yabani. Abuhu, his father, fil yabani, is in Japan. Huwa tajirun kabirun. He is a big businessman. Huwa tajirun kabirun. Abuhu fil yabani. Huwa tajirun kabirun. His father is in Japan. He is a big businessman. Tajirun kabirun is na'at and man'ut. Alaka akhun ya Muhammadu. Alaka akhun ya Muhammadu. A is for question. Laka. Ka is you, the damir for you. And la is actually the harful jar that we've already done before, which is li. Li is the original harful jar. And when you combine lika, just as we did earlier, ma'aka, ma'aka was with you. Now we say lika, meaning belonging to you or for you. Lika is a little difficult in pronunciation, so the Arabs made it simpler and they said for pronunciation purposes only, the kasra on li, we will change it into a fatha and say la. So you say laka, meaning belonging to you. Alaka akhun, do you have a brother? Ya Muhammadu, O Muhammad. Alaka akhun ya Muhammad, do you have a brother belonging to you, O Muhammad? Muhammad replies, na'am. Notice when you're saying do you have a brother, you use laka. You do not say indaka. You say laka when you say do you have a brother. And this point will be made later on in the exercises. Muhammad replies saying, na'am, yes, li akhun wahidun. Li is the harful jar, meaning belonging to or for. Ya after it is the dhamir for me or mine. Li, belonging to me. Akhun, the origin of this is akhun li. A brother is belonging to me. A brother is for me, meaning I have a brother. Now, you simply put the li before and akhun after, because akhun does not have al. So you say li akhun, although you can say it either way. Li akhun wahidun. Wahidun means one, and the number one comes as an adjective, a na'at, to whatever you are describing. Akhun wahidun is na'at and man'ut. Akhun wahidun, one brother. Notice akhun, if it is mudaf, you will add a waw along with dhamma. But because it's not mudaf, there is no waw. You simply say akhun wahidun. Li akhun wahidun. I have one brother. Ismuhu usamatu. Ismuhu usamatu. Ismuhu is mudaf ilayh, meaning name of his. Name of his is Usama. Meaning the name of my brother is Usama. You could have said ismi, ismu akhi usamatu, but he simply preferred to say ismuhu usamatu. His name is Usama. Wa huwa ma'i huna fil madinati al munawwarati. Wa huwa, and he is ma'i, with me. Huna, over here. Fi, in al madinati, in the city. Al munawwarati. Al munawwarati is adjective to al madina. Wa huwa ma'i huna fi al-madinati al-munawwarati, and he is here with me in Madina Munawwara. وهو معي هنا في المدينة المنورة. And he is here with me in the مدينة المنورة. ولي أخت واحدة. ولي أخت واحدة. لي like before لي أخ واحد belonging to me is one brother. Here he's now saying لي أخت واحدة. و and لي belonging to me أخت a sister. واحدة one. واحدة is نعت adjective for أخت. أخت is مؤنث feminine. Therefore واحد now transforms into واحدتن. You add a ta at the end to make it into a feminine. That's why earlier we said أخن واحدن, because أخ is masculine, so we said أخن واحدن. Now we say أختن واحدتن, because أختن is feminine, واحدن becomes واحدتن. ولي أختن واحدتن, and I have one sister. اسمها زينب. اسمها, the name of hers, her name is زينب, is زينب. اسمها زينب. زينب is name of a female person, therefore it does not have تنوين at the end. ولي أخت واحدة, I have a sister. اسمها زينب, her name is زينب. وهي في العراق مع زوجها. وهي في العراق, and she is في العراق. She is in Iraq. Iraq, of course, the country. وهي في العراق, and she is in Iraq. مع زوجها. مع means with, and زوجي has كسرة because of مع before it. And زوجي is مضاف, and ها is مضاف إليه. زوجها, her husband. مع زوجها, with her husband. So he's saying, وهي في العراق, and she is in Iraq, مع زوجها, along with her husband. زوجها, her husband, is مهندس, an engineer. Notice earlier we said زوجها, because of مع before زوج, it made زوجو into زوجي. Now in the new sentence, we say زوجها مهندس, her husband is an engineer. So the whole sentence read again is, and try to understand the meaning as I read it. نعم لي أخ واحد اسمه أسامة وهو معي هنا في المدينة المنورة ولي أخت واحدة اسمها زينب وهي في العراق مع زوجها زوجها مهندس. حامد asks for the last time, أعندك سيارة يا أخي؟ يا أخي, أخ is brother, E is my brother. يا أخي, my brother. عندك سيارة, عند means with, ك you, with you. سيارة, is there a car with you? Meaning, is there a car? Do you have a car? And this is a way of asking, do you have something? You say, أعندك سيارة يا أخي? Do you have a car, O brother? When you're asking, do you have a brother? You don't use عندك. You say, you use لك. ألك أخ? ألك أخت? When you're asking about a human relations, such as brother, sister, you say ألك أخ ألك أخت. When you're asking about an object, do you have an object, such as a car, you say أعندك سيارة يا أخي. Muhammad replies لا, no, ما عندي سيارة, I do not have a car. ما عندي سيارة, I do not have a car. عندي, عندك, with you. عندي, with me. سيارة, ما is simply for negating. عندي سيارة, I have a car. ما عندي سيارة, I do not have a car. لا, ما عندي سيارة, no, I do not have a car. عندي دراجة, I have a bicycle. عندي, with me, دراجة, a bicycle, I have a bicycle. حمزة عنده سيارة. حمزة عنده with him is سيارة أي car. حمزة عنده سيارة. حمزة with him is a car. You could try making sentences of these types, and the more you do, the easier it will be for you. Sentences such as saying, أعندك قلم يا أخي؟ أعندك قلم يا أخي؟ And the answer, لا, ما عندي قلم, عندي كتاب. محمد عنده قلم. And sentences such as this, they would help you to use عندي, عندك, عنده all together in simply one small short conversation. I'll read the passage one more time and see if you can understand as we go through before moving on to the تمارين. من أنت؟ أنا طالب بالجامعة. أأنت طالب جديد؟ نعم أنا طالب جديد. من أين أنت؟ أنا من الهند. ما اسمك؟ اسمي محمد. ومن هذا الفتى الذي معك؟ هو زميلي. أهو أيضا من الهند؟ لا، هو من اليابان. ما اسمه؟ اسمه حمزة. ما لغتك يا محمد؟ لغتي الأردية. أهي لغة سهلة؟ نعم هي لغة سهلة. وحمزة ما لغته؟ لغته اليابانية وهي لغة صعبة. أين أبوك يا محمد؟ أبي في الكويت، هو طبيب شهير. وأين أمك؟ هي أيضا في الكويت مع أبي، هي مدرسة هناك. هي مدرسة هناك. أذهبت إلى الكويت يا محمد؟ نعم ذهبت. وزميلك أين أبوه؟ أبوه في اليابان، هو تاجر كبير. ألك أخ يا محمد؟ نعم لي أخ واحد اسمه أسامة، وهو معي هنا في المدينة المنورة. ولي أخت واحدة اسمها زينب، وهي في العراق مع زوجها. زوجها مهندس. أعندك سيارة يا أخي؟ لا، ما عندي سيارة. عندي دراجة. حمزة عنده سيارة. This passage is quite long and there are a lot of usages of the few rules that we have learnt. You would do well to listen to this passage a couple of times again and to read it yourself in order to familiarize yourself better with this passage. Since this lesson has 9 exercises after it, and they would take quite a while to go through them, I'm going to pause this recording now and come back to the exercises in a separate recording, such that if you wanted, you could come back and listen to only the passage section again and in this recording, and for the exercises, just listen to the other recording on its own. So, ولله الحمد والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله.